Penguin Random House Audio presents Vanishing Games by Roger Hobbs. Read for you by Jake Weber. Prologue. The South China Sea. A few hours before dawn on the morning of his last job, Sabo Park got down on his belly next to the rifle on the bow of his fishing boat, eased forward into a comfortable shooting position, and flipped open the lens cap on his night vision scope. After quickly double-checking the sight-in, he took out a pair of white earbuds, put them in, and pressed play on his iPod. The only song on the playlist was Nina Simone's Sinner Man, 10 minutes and 20 seconds long. When it was over, Sabo was going to kill as many people as he could. Here's the deal. The South China Sea has more active smugglers than any other place in the world. The sea connects ports in China, the Philippines, Malaysia, Taiwan, and Vietnam. More cargo rolls through that puddle than anywhere else in the region. Most of it is legitimate, of course, but not all of it. Any illegal product worth selling goes through there. Human traffickers in Cambodia load up old cargo containers with children, throw them a couple cans of Ensure and a bucket for waste, then ship them wholesale to sell as slaves in China. In Vietnam, cartels send out flotillas so packed with Golden Triangle dope that they can barely stay afloat. Every day, go-fast boats packed with counterfeit luxury goods make it out of Hong Kong, and fishing ships loaded with illicit whale meat come north for the hungry Japanese. Meth comes from Thailand, guns come from Russia, fake money comes from North Korea, and bootlegs come from Shanghai. The South China Sea, for better or worse, is the epicenter of illegal shipping in the world. And where there's illegal shipping, there are pirates. When most people think of a pirate, they don't have a guy like Sabo Park in mind. Modern pirates are supposed to be Somalian kids with AKs who are hopped up on cot, not skinny Koreans with a propensity for seasickness. Sabo looked more like a fashion model than a hardened criminal. He stood 6'6" and wore a Hugo Boss windbreaker, a blue pinstriped Eton shirt, tight-fitting jeans, and a pair of $1,200 designer boots that had never seen mud. He had a Rolex Daytona and an iPod plated with 14-karat gold. Only the thick cotton ski mask and the latex gloves revealed his true purpose. Sabo Park was an armed robber. But tonight he wasn't stealing just anything. He was after something small enough to fit in the palm of his hand and valuable enough to buy a whole cargo container of Golden Triangle heroin. Over the years, thousands of men like him had fought and died for these things, because Sabo's target was, by weight, one of the most valuable substances in the world. Tonight, Sabo was going to steal a blue sapphire. You see, more than half of the world's blue sapphires are smuggled at one point or another, because the best ones come from a little place called Burma. Specifically, they come from the town of Mogok in the Mandalay region. The problem is, Burma isn't a place anymore. The country now calls itself Myanmar, because for a few decades it was ruled by a military junta who ran the whole place into the ground. The nation's bosses still sent people into the pits to pan for sapphires, sure, but every stone they pulled out was supposed to go directly to a state-supported gem dealer who'd mark it up a few thousand percent and pass the profits over to the regime. For some people, that markup just wouldn't do. Even now that Myanmar is taking some baby steps toward democracy, the markup's still there. So there are smugglers. A lot of smugglers. And worse, the independent narco armies who control the north are finally getting in on the action, in order to supplement the drug money that pays for their perpetual civil war. More than $1 billion of illegal gemstones get out each year. Every year, like clockwork. There are two major smuggling routes, the cheap way and the good way. The former is for crummy stones, which take the long route. First, a miner has to sneak the stone out from under his military-supported taskmaster's nose. This can be pretty tough. The miners are often children, sometimes as young as 7, who put in 18-hour days in blistering heat or freezing cold, panning through gravel and cholera water with their bare hands for tiny colored rocks worth more than their entire village. Once they find one, they have to hide it, or it will be taken away. You'd think there are lots of ways to hide a stone, but there aren't, and the taskmasters are wise to most of them. Only one method really works. Before anybody notices, the miner has to take that muddy hunk of rock, pop it in his mouth, and swallow the fucker whole. No simple task. A sapphire has a hardness of 9 on the Mohs scale, making it just slightly softer than a diamond. If the stone has a jagged edge, even a millimeter long, it could be as dangerous as swallowing a razor blade. And the kid can't just throw it up later, either. No. That rock has to go through everything. Throat, stomach, intestines, colon. Then, if it finally passes, the miner's gotta pick it out of his own blood-soaked feces, wash it off, and bring it to market. Once there, a fat Chinese guy with a jeweler's loop examines the rock and gives the kid some money. The kid doesn't get much because he's basically a slave, but even a little money can go a long way in the pits. Once the Chinese broker gets a bunch of stones together, he sells them to a Thai drug dealer in exchange for heroin. Heroin is better than currency in Myanmar. The heroin dealer then stuffs the stones in his car and drives to Tachi Lake, a tiny village near the border to both Thailand and Laos. When he arrives, he trades the sapphires to a border crosser for more heroin, who then hides the sapphires in bags of rice and smuggles them across the river into Thailand on a bicycle or a big farm truck. Easy as can be. In my side, the rocks are pawned off to legitimate jewelry dealers under the pretense that they came from local Thai or Laotian mines. Since the sapphires are low quality, the lie holds up. The dealers mix the illegal stones with the legal ones and sell them off wholesale to retailers around the world. The rest is obvious. Rinse, repeat. This route is small time, however. No money in it. The real players don't care about little one-carat stones with milky centers and no color. The serious money comes from smuggling the big world-class sapphires. 10 carats or more, no flaws, clear center, bright color, perfect hue. The story starts the same. Miner, Chinese guy, heroin. After that, though, the serious smuggling rings take over. Instead of going to a border town like Mai Sai or Mae Hong Son, they pick up the stones for a pittance in Mandalay, hide them in their gas tanks or elsewhere in their vehicles, and drive a few hundred kilometers down to the port city of Rangoon. Hell, if the shipment's big enough, they don't bother being subtle. They just put the sapphires on an armored convoy with a bunch of armed guards and shoot it out with anybody who's asking for it. Once the stones make it to Rangoon, they're loaded onto a small fishing vessel or some other inconspicuous boat that hauls them out to international waters. This, of course, is the most dangerous part. The smugglers not only have to get past the Burmese Coast Guard, who are hard to bribe, but also have to sail more than 1,000 kilometers around the tip of Malaysia, through the pirate-heavy waters of Thailand and Vietnam, to the monsoon-ridden South China Sea. That's when they reach Hong Kong, the city where you can buy anything. It's a perilous journey, but if the ship makes it there safely, even a small handful of those stones can become a hefty fortune on the international jewelry market. And if your poison is gemstones, that's the place to be. Hong Kong's got more jewelry stores per square mile than anywhere else on Earth. It puts New York and Antwerp to shame. Kowloon is the candy land of shined-up rocks. The profits are obscene. The sky's the limit. Stores there have sapphires as blue as the Pacific Ocean and as clear as a shard of glass. They've got uncut rubies the size of a testicle and as radiant as an evening star. You could buy a watch covered with diamonds or a cell phone plated with platinum if you wanted to. There are four C's for gemstones: cut, clarity, color, and carat. If you take a 5-minute walk down Canton Road in Hong Kong, you'll see every combination of those traits.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.